Welcome to October, the month of momentum. And going into it right now, I have tremendous momentum, starting it off in the right way. On September 30th, 2012, making the video, if you want to help the world, don't play the role of the hero. It's as if I came across something of extreme value. And it's been about 12 hours now since I taped that video. And there's this inner sense of excitement, anticipation. This feeling is still reverberating. It's been reverberating the entire time. And it is a feeling like I can only express it as if you come across something and you realize, oh my gosh, I have just found something of extreme value. Let me put it this way. Let it say you are a miner and you are searching for gold nuggets, and you're in some mine, you know, hacking away at the wall, hacking out little nuggets. You get a little bit here, a little bit here, a little bit here. And you've been doing this for a long, long time. That's your life, is a miner for precious gold, let's say. And one day you're hacking into the wall again with your pick, you know, and sledgehammer, and bam, bam, bam. And you see something. What is that? And you keep hitting it, and it seems like there's some gold there, and you keep on chipping away, chip, 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 chip. And it looks like there's this big nugget. You keep chipping away, and it's bigger and bigger and bigger, and you say, holy cow, there's this gigantic nugget of gold there. And you're just sitting there, says, you know, shaking, you know, like, wow. All this time I've been just getting little nuggets, little nuggets, little nuggets, little nuggets, maybe some kind of nice size, but this one's gigantic. That is the feeling that I'm having. And, you know, not sure, just to say, wow. Wow, that's a big one. That's huge. That's bigger than I expected. So there is this that sense is reverberating, continuing to reverberate. And I just went about my day in a very normal manner on a Sunday, taking it easy, lounging around, just, you know. But all the while, there's this realization, like I've come across something of extreme value. Saw duality. I understand what duality is really talking about now. And saw the trickeration of existence. And the whole thing was like laid bare. Just laid bare. The whole thing was just laid bare. And I cannot disguise the fact that, you know, seeing it. I had a glimpse of it in October 1978. October has always been my month of breakthroughs. And so it's been, what, 34 years since that time when I had a glimpse of it while I was sleeping. I had an episode of, what, you know, of enlightenment or clarification, of pure clarification. And I saw duality, I saw the trick, I saw everything, and then I realized I was going to fall back into ignorance of it. But I also, as I started to lose track and fall into ignorance, I knew that if I just worked at it and kept working at it, I'd be able to see it clearly, and not just during sleep for an instant, you know, but it would be a permanent fixture. This clarification, very pure clarity. And so 34 years later, after working on it constantly for 34 years, I have this sense, you know, that it's very clear. Not some, you know, I'm not asleep in a dream and I have a brief moment of pure clarity, but it's with me all the time. You know, I see it. Can explain it, you know, just like that. And so this is producing kind of this anticipation, expectation, like, wow, I have something of real tremendous value now. Aligned with this waking up during sleep 34 years ago. I also had some experiences of being suffused with like this sweetness, just a complete sweetness, unbelievable sweetness, suffused with it. And that lasted, I woke up and it lasted, it lingered on for a while when I woke up. I was like permeated with it. You know, stuff happened. So seeing this now, you know, I expect stuff to happen. I really do. I don't know what. I really don't know what. I'm not really thinking about anything in particular. I just have a sense that it will be put in the right context now. It won't be put in the heroic context. It won't be put in a context of trying to protect the good from the bad, or trying to make the good better, or trying to defeat the bad, or trying to be the hero. Any of this context, any of this trickery that's going on, I just simply abide in it. Just abide in it. I can see how that is the correct thing to do. And this is causing like, like, you know, there's some deep upwelling of excitement or anticipation. Something is there. Something is like emerging, you know. Wow. Yeah, I feel normal, but everything feels normal, yet there is this kind of inner hum going on, like something is probably going to take place. There's something coming, something great, great, super. Some peace of mind is on its way. It's kind of like the door has been opened. It's kind of like that. You open this door and you feel the breeze. You say, oh my gosh, you know, I've opened the door. The way is open. Understanding. Love your enemy. Resist not evil. Agree with your adversary. Understanding that very clearly. How doing nothing here was what brings peace to the world. Really. I don't need to do anything. It's to resist not evil here actually causes the evil to slink away and go into a more quiescent state. See? Seeing all of that. And therefore, peace can come and will not be projected, thrown away, you know, to like, oh, I need to bring peace to the world. No. It's simply abiding in peace. Lessens the dynamics of duality. They kind of subside a bit, because they're not going to get the result they're looking for. They're looking for the heroic action to take place, and you're the opposite of heroic action. You are simply not going to do anything. You're simply abiding in this peace, and this peace enables you to not do anything. You don't want to leave it. You don't want to go out and be active. You simply want to abide in it like Ramana Maharshi did. And Anandamayi did, just abide in this. And this literally then causes the whole setup, the whole trickeration of the good guys and the bad guys and the threat and that trying to sucker in hero activity, sucker us into action, trying to do something about it. And that reinforces our belief that we can create a power that can threaten reality. Really, it really does. I see how it works. So by doing nothing, by not jumping into the hero role at all, by simply being not even the slightest bit interested in doing anything, the whole setup of the good damsel in distress, as I call it, and the evil, the wicked that's coming to ravish and destroy the damsel in distress, both of those have to back away from the confrontation. And they say, we're not going to get that hero effect that we're trying to generate through this clever interplay. See, the good and the bad are in cahoots on a deep level. Consciously, we will say, oh, no, that's not possible. At a deep level, they absolutely are in cahoots. It's a setup. It's a total setup. They're not two separate. They don't come from two separate causal agents. They come from one causal agent. And they're setting up this trap, you see. So if you do nothing, they say, oh, there's no one to fall into this trap. And so we need to work on making the trap better. We're not going to have the confrontation. So the confrontation is postponed. Is postponed. And so you have opportunity with the lessening and postponing of the confrontation, as it were. You feel a sense of insulation from it, and you're able to work on seeing clearly, which is the only work there really is more clarification, really, because it's amazing when you see it. You just say bingo, 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 bingo. Wow, there is this dynamic we're not aware of, is resist not evil, that actually again causes the bully to back away, this bully of existence to back away, as it's thinking, how do I retool this whole setup to get the hero to spring into action? And they, you know, have to rethink everything and reconsider it, and so that, you know, there's not this terrible conflict that's going to, you know, draw the hero into action, because the hero, there is no hero there. See, you have to rethink it and try to set it up a trickier trap, which buys us time, which enables us to focus on clarification. So this seeing this, not just conceptually hearing it, but actually seeing it. I saw it very clearly in my mind's eye, in my mind, I saw it. This is what's going on. This is reverberating, reverberating, reverberating. Doot, 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 doot. Just like reverberations there, like, whoa, I just came across this intense value. Existence laid bare, you know, the whole trickeration suddenly laid bare. Which is the same thing that happened 34 years ago. But I was asleep at the time, and I kind of woke up from the sleep, and I realized, holy cow, I'm enlightened. I see duality. I understand the trick of duality. Saw it all, and I knew it's a trick. But then I fell back asleep. I couldn't remember what the trick was. Could not remember what it was, and I've been struggling nonstop for 34 years to see that trick again. And then suddenly today, I saw it. More clearly than ever, more clearly than back then, you know, it's really, and it's staying with me. It's not like a fluke, you know, it's not like a fluke thing. It's not like I went into fasting and made some extreme efforts, you know, and suddenly I had this brief, you know, flash of intuition. And no, it's not a fluke at all. I mean, it seems very natural and normal to just a part of this, you know, progression of just seeing more and more clearly. It's just that suddenly, you know, so much came into focus at one time. I said, hey, this is it. So, you know, I'm fine. And yet there is this hum, you know, of anticipation within. There is this hum, like reverberation, a feeling of wow. October is going to be an incredible month. I can feel it. And what an evening we have here. It's like 10:30 on the West Coast, California, Bay Area. It was 95 degrees here today. And the evening is warm. The crickets are just going to town. It's just incredibly, the dusk, and this was just beautiful, just beautiful. Everything was so crystal clear and soft and warm. And just, wow, what an incredible day. What an incredible day. Really kicking off this October, which is shaping up to be just the greatest month ever. And how does this help all of you? You can feel it too, that this is a month of momentum. And whatever momentum you have, expect it. Expect to ride that momentum. You have to ride it. You have to drive it. I feel like I've just gotten the keys to a car. You know, like someone handed me the keys to a car. It's that sense of excitement, right? Imagine if someone came to you and handed you these keys, and you looked at them and said, oh my gosh, you just handed me the keys to a car. And when do I get to see the car? It says, tomorrow you'll get to drive it or whatever. And you're feeling like that. It's like, whoa, I'm excited. I can hardly wait to drive that car. So in October, we drive the momentum that we've built up. We're the drivers, and we're riding that momentum, riding on those wheels. And I'm just like, you know, almost a little stunned, you know, but it's not a problem. It's just like, oh my gosh, I got the keys to the car. I got the keys to the kingdom. You know, I got the keys to the kingdom dropped in my hand finally. And like, again, I keep checking. It's not a fluke. That excitement is continuously there for 12 straight hours. It's still there. Just going through regular days. I watched a couple of baseball games, checked all the baseball scores, and surfed the internet, went to church, you know, cooked dinner, picked some stuff in the garden, just going about a Sunday, getting ready for work on a Monday. But inside, dum, 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 you know, got the keys to the car. What's going to happen tomorrow? It's like that. It's a wow feeling. Kind of like a positive nervous feeling. Not a fearful nervous feeling, more of a positive one. Like you got the keys to the car. You're going to see the car in the driveway, you know, very soon. That sort of feeling, like, wow. If these are the keys, you know what's going to follow is the car is going to follow. It's going to be a heck of a car. That is for sure. And how did I feel in church? You know, I said, well, you know, in church, they're basically teaching the teachings of belief. But truth is beyond belief. It's beyond belief. It's obvious. You hear the teachings, and it's based on belief's interpretation of truth, which is it's not correct at all. Cannot be. The same feeling just maintained the whole time during church, during all the singing, everything. Didn't change anything at all. Didn't felt the same. Like just. Focus was right there. I didn't feel at all bothered by whatever was being taught and everything. I said, oh, that's just, you know, the teachings of belief is just what, you know, almost everything in this world is the teachings of belief. Putting words in God's mouth, all that stuff. I said, but hey, I have the keys to the car. And you can imagine someone who spent 34 years nonstop in frantic effort suddenly, finally reaching that point, you know, of seeing it, this is it. You might imagine, you know, the inside there's this feeling like this is really great. You know, this is big time. So it's unusual that it has not worn off at all. This kind of feeling has just stayed steady. And whatever I do, it's still there. It's still there. If I focus on it, it gets a little more intense. Like something tells me I'm into something good. Don't know exactly what. I really don't. I don't have a clue. Really. Not yet. Don't know what's coming. But, don't really need much more clarity, I would think, really. I don't think that's really required at this point. I see it. I think what's required, you know, something now is I don't know. I really don't know. But I don't really seem to be worried about it. We'll find out. It's kind of like, you know, a car, there's going to be a car in the driveway tomorrow, and you don't know what kind of car it's going to be. No one's told you what kind of car. So that's the feeling I'm having. You know, wow. Tomorrow, you know, I'm going to see what the car is like. I don't know. You know, is it going to be a, you know, a Volkswagen? Is it going to be a, you know, a Chevrolet, Fiat, Toyota, a hybrid, electric, a BMW, a Mercedes, you know, Porsche, I don't know, Buick, Dodge, Ford, you know, SUV, an Audi, maybe it's be an Audi, I don't know. So it's just like this sense of not really knowing what's next at all, knowing something is really great's gonna happen, but not knowing what it is. It's like night before Christmas. You know there's gonna be presents under the tree, and you see them, you know, or you know Santa's gonna come, but you don't know what Santa's gonna leave as presents. That is the kind of feeling I'm having right now. Night before Christmas, Christmas Eve, Christ Mass Eve, you know. What kind of gifts of the Spirit are gonna, you know, be under the tree, so to speak? What is coming? I don't know. I have, you know, I can speculate. Something that, again, is so delightful that I have no desire to play the role of the hero. I would say that's what it's going to be. Something that you can just sit there quietly, without wanting to do anything, and feel total sense of fulfillment and a super richness of experiencing without having to do anything. That is what I expect. Because the whole purpose of this gifts of the Spirit, the whole purpose is to insulate you from being suckered into trying to play the role of the hero and defeat evil, oppose and defeat evil. That's the whole purpose of it, is to not get suckered into that. So therefore, it gives you an experiencing, non-stop, steady experiencing that is so wonderful, you don't feel any need, and you can't be seduced in any way into the role of the hero, because you have everything you want right here, right now, seamlessly and continuously, 24 hours a day. So that is what I expect. Not needing anything outside, a holy experience that is has everything in it, not missing any parts, in other words, holy experience. Total experience that you don't need to search for something else to add to it, and that'll sucker you into the role of the hero, because you think, the evil is destroying the good, and I need to get something from the good, and the evil's trying to destroy it, so I need to destroy the evil, you know, and that only reinforces delusion. Reinforces it. So I absolutely do expect that there will be some suffusement to the extent where I don't feel any need whatsoever to add anything to it, to play the hero's role. And no matter what happens in the world, it won't touch it. And that is protection. That is really the way that we're insulated, and the grace of God insulating us from this, the trickeration of existence and how it's trying to sucker us into believing that there's two causal agents in the dream, and that you need to get rid of the one that is harming the other, you see, and that there's a way to get rid of it, all that. That's all the trick, the trap of existence. It's all the trap of existence. And so we need something that enables us to not get pulled into that trap at all. And when we see the trap, then we'll be willing to accept this experience and put it in the right context, like it's just simply here to enable us to just abide in this, so we won't be suckered into the trap. That's what it's for. And put it in the right context. When we see the right context, I believe this experiencing will show up. And so I've got the right context now, so that's why I'm expecting, hey, you know, something is going to show up. There's going to be a car in the driveway, you know. It's all about seeing it in the right context. And my mind feels very much comfortable and okay with that. It's not going to cause any sort of confusion or bewilderment or panic or what do I do with this? Why is this here? Why me? You know, all this. None of that. None of that. You know, easy acceptance. See exactly what it's for. It's not that it's not compassionate, you know, not playing the role of the hero doesn't mean you're not being compassionate, just the opposite. If we were to simply sit quietly in a situation and do nothing, and merely abide in this total non-action, total non-reaction, total bliss, just abide in that, you will literally find the trauma and the struggle and conflict around that area will subside. Will subside by doing nothing. But it's a pure doing nothing. It's abiding in bliss. If you want to bring peace to earth, temporary peace, but to peace, temporary peace to earth, that's what you do. That's what you would do. That's what it's possible, absolutely. There's still, we need to still then choose a different causal agent, which brings us an even greater, you know, perfect freedom from this idea. But in the meantime, before we do that, we can abide in this non-action, non-heroic state of not opposing anything. And that will bring a lessening of the conflict in the world. We call it bringing peace to the world, where people just feel that they're, that, you know, at this moment there's nothing to be gained from the conflict because there's no heroic action there to jump in, you know. So yeah, by doing nothing, by abiding in this perfect positive non-action of bliss, you absolutely calm down conflict to an unimaginable extent, more than trying to play the hero role, which actually feeds the fire down the road. It may seem like it's doing something now, but it actually feeds the fire of a delusion. And yet, who can have this positive non-action? Not a matter of just willfully not taking action. It's not like the hero is like restraining themselves. It is a state where you literally don't have any inclination to have action. You don't have to try and hold yourself back or restrain yourself. There's no effort to even restrain yourself. You're experiencing complete fulfillment right where you are. And people will say, well, that's selfish. And you know, no, we just explained it is actually supremely compassionate and actually does help bring this temporary peace in the world, which then helps everybody focus and say, wait a minute, okay, let me see, you know, what's going on with this very tricky existence that we're in. Provides a much greater opportunity to awaken from this dream, to choose a different causal agent. So it's not selfish at all, just the opposite. It helps everything, helps all of existence. Abiding in this positive, effortless non-action helps the entire universe calm down. So it's the opposite of being selfish. It's being effective. Truly effective. So it's the highest service to get the right context so that this you know, bliss, this whatever it is, that gives effortless non-action can arrive and be accepted in the right context. It's like a guest coming to your home, and you have everything set up for the guest. You have a little studio. You have the bed, the desk, the chair, the tables, the dresser, The bathroom, the kitchen, everything is there. It's all set up. The guest comes in and you say, welcome, welcome here. Make yourself at home. You know, my house is your house. It's your house as much as mine. Make yourself at home. And then the guest comes in and just, you know, seamless integration there. There's no conflicts or squabbles or anything. You just hang out and sit out in the back patio and watch the flowers grow, you know. Just enjoy, 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 enjoy. So when you're ready for that guest to arrive, the guest will arrive. But you have to have the context, your house set up for it. So you know why the guest came. You know exactly why. You're not all confused, like, who is this guest that came to my house? You know, why are they here? I don't know if I can live with them, all this stuff. No, you say, no, I know exactly why they're here. I know what they are, who they are, why they're here, what their purpose is. It's all great, it's wonderful. Come on in, you know, no problem whatsoever. That's the benefit of the spiritual path, is you get the right context. Through clarification, greater and greater clarification, you're arranging your house, you're setting up the context properly so that guests can arrive. Wow, and just amazing, isn't it, how we've been, you know, so confused and bamboozled by the existence that we think that these people who are just, you know, non-action, just quiet, just sitting there in bliss and peace, we think, what are they doing? You know, they're wasting their lives. How come they're not taking action? How come they could be heroes and instead they're just doing nothing? And we denigrate this, you know, and think that it's foolish. We can't understand it all. Oh my gosh, just the opposite. Just the opposite. And we don't even have to ask now, what kind of effect did Ramana and Anandamayi Ma have on the world? You know, we can see it now. Wow. Must have had an enormous effect on the world. And the others who were in this effortless bliss, enormous effect on the world. Calmed down the world enormously. It's like turning down the flame, you know, on your pot. All the boiling subsides and the, you know, some steam still rising, but there's no boiling. The surface isn't roiling, right? But now it's been a while since Ramana passed away and Anandamayi Ma passed away. I think Ramana was in 1950 something two or whatever, and Anandamayi Ma 1982. And the pot is starting to boil again. We've been turning the heat up. And the heat has gotten so high now, the pot is just furiously boiling, you know. But if they hadn't have come and this perfect non-action, perfect unconcern, just can't imagine what the agitation would be like. I mean, it literally, they could have prevented an all-out nuclear war, literally. I imagine they did simply by doing nothing perfectly. It really causes the entire dynamic of existence to back away from its confrontation. It has to. Because it feels like the hero quotient isn't strong enough. The hero is reluctant. We have a reluctant hero here. It doesn't seem like they're going to jump in, so we need to back away from this confrontation. And that, you know, there were times, you know, growing up in the Cold War, during the nuclear age, many times I and many of us felt that there was going to be a nuclear confrontation, a holocaust, nuclear holocaust. It was very much possible, and it almost happened several times, really. Very close. And we were terrified of that. But, and the fact that it didn't happen, I know a lot of people felt that there's some kind of divine grace that literally caused this nuclear confrontation to the parties to back away from it. You know, we just barely missed it. Just barely missed it. And it comes from this perfect, effortless non-action in the world here. That literally causes confrontation to back away. The parties involved in the confrontation to back away, and say we can't go all out right now. No, it's not going to work. It's not going to work. Is it possible that could happen now? Sure, it's possible. I don't know if it will happen or not. If the confrontation that's seems to be coming, if that can ease up and the parties can back away simply by effortless non-action. That's the most powerful agent in this dream, is effortless non-action. Non-opposition. But it has to be effortless. Otherwise, it doesn't work. And it can only be effortless if one is experiencing this holiness, the sense of holiness, that nothing is missing. Then it's effortless, because one will simply say, I've got everything I want. Nothing is missing. I don't need to gain the accolades of the world at all. I don't need to be a hero at all. I already feel totally at peace with what I am, totally satisfied. Only then can it be literally effortless. No need to make an effort at all. And it's this effortless peace, tranquility, non-action, non-resistance, all this effortlessness that brings about the parties of confrontation to back away. So this is the principle. But you know, it is temporary. It is temporary. Yeah. Because those believing in belief, you know, will be working to reset the whole thing and make a more clever, you know, confrontation, etc. And it's a temporary thing. It's not permanent fix. Permanent fix is to choose a new idea. But it does buy us time. It is a grace of God that gives us some time to focus in on inquiry, you know. Inquiry, inquiry, inquiry. Because when all hell breaks loose in confrontation and the hero's jumping around, we've got like a, you know, superhero movie on our hands. You know, we're not going to just be doing this very, very elegant inquiry. A very patient and elegant inquiry of just careful, patient observation. And we're not going to be doing that. You know, we got the superhero jumping all over the place and the action, you know, movies just, you know, nonstop. You don't see in those movies, the movie suddenly stops and you see someone just sitting there doing nothing, just inquiry. You know, you've got the superhero chasing down the villain and rescuing the damsel in distress. That's what you have, and it's nonstop. So, we don't want that kind of, you know, action to break out. Now, when Ramana and Anandamayi were here, there was World War I, World War II, you know, so the stuff still broke out. But it could have been much worse. And we avoided the very worst thing, which would be a nuclear holocaust, you know. We avoided it. Up to this point, we have. And, we certainly need to avoid it again, because we're headed in that direction again. The politicians get the credit for, you know, peace and stuff, and which is fine, but they're not the ones doing it at all. It's the effortless non-action that actually brings it about. So certainly I welcome such a development, absolutely welcome it. Come on in. Because it's explainable. It's not something weird, and not at all. It's absolutely explainable. And one can see, you know, why it works. Everything is there if one wants to see it, you know. But most people are so wrapped up in, you know, the hero role that they're trying to figure out how to be a superhero. You know, people are working on, they need psychic powers, you know, working on psychic powers. You see these cartoons that kids are watching, it's all about superpowers, psychic powers, and being superheroes. It's all about that. You know, flying here, flying there, zapping with energy. Always fighting the bad guys, you know, with all these, you know, power stuff, you know, zing, and all this, you know, it's all these astral battles, these battles with psychic powers and energy, all that kind of stuff. That's, you know, that is saturating the youth of the world and leading them astray, severely astray. So with all of that stuff, the world is really hyped up on everybody wants to get this conflict going so the superheroes can jump in, you know, and show their stuff and be validated and all this kind of stuff, which is exactly the trap that existence sets. It's exactly it. And if no one wanted to jump in, there wouldn't be conflict. Conflict would have to wait. That is a fact. So if everybody had been doing inquiry, you know, over the last 50 years, there wouldn't be any conflict, really. Very minor. There couldn't be any, you know, big to-do, because it would have to wait. It would have to wait. Nobody's interested in jumping in. But not everyone has been doing inquiry for the past 50 years or 25 years or however old you are. But there have been some. There have been some. And those who have been doing it, is what I'm suggesting, is they need to get that, ride the momentum now. Ride it, you know. Maybe there'll be some intensive somewhere. I don't know. It'll be a good idea. If you're, you know, if you've been doing inquiry, I suggest, you know, intensive now, or to ride what your very best, you know, ride the momentum, something greater than what you've done before. To bring out the very best in you now. To get your house, get your context in order. Maybe they'll be intensive. I don't know. It's possible. I mean, I'd see how that could possibly take place. If I were in some place that's very insulated and in a condition of effortless non-action, then intensives could take place for those who have been in inquiry intense inquiry, and they're really get it. You know, they're okay with it. They realize there is a goal. And they realize the goal is to see the trickeration of existence, to see through it, you know. And they realize there is this whole grace there, and just this feeling of okayness with all of that. Then those people could conceivably benefit from some sort of intensive just sitting, you know, in non-action, around non-action. Hanging out with non-action is the most profound satsang of all. I don't know anyone in the world that is like that, that is truly like that. Hanging out in effortless, perfect non-action. Just hanging out with around that is super helpful. Super helpful, because you start to feel okay with it. And that is the most important thing. Because then you can make progress. When you realize you're okay with it, you say, hey, then might as well, you know, go for it. But again, that's all speculative. I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen in the future. Exactly, you know. But the sense is that there is something really great coming. Just in the nick of time. I'm always on time for some reason. I don't know why. But if you ever had a situation where you wanted someone to show up right on time, I'm the one who does that for some reason. I will, if someone says you need to be here at, 10:25 and 20 seconds, somehow I walk through the door at to the second. Not even trying to. It's always been that way. It's unbelievable. And if I'm trying to get someplace early, I'll take a wrong turn, I'll get lost, and I'll end up finally, getting back to the place, and I'll walk on the door right on the second. It's really something. I don't know where that comes from. But I got this sense of assurance that I'll show up right on time. And again, like I said, just before October started, I was able to get this, this total clarity, to seeing it all. And so whatever else needs to take place, it's going to happen right on time as well. I have confidence in that. Whatever it may be, but I feel it has to have something to do with effortless non-action, which means experiencing a total experiencing that is completely fulfilling without doing anything. And then that somehow is going to help others too in some way. I don't know the particulars. I suspect something might happen. It's, very possible. But, hey, who knows? First things first. So, we're going into October 2012. In spite of what the media would tell you about December 21st, 2012, it's nothing, it's not nothing. These times are not inconsequential. I mean, as far as stuff happening, no, stuff is happening. Now, it may not be, the literal end of the world, that kind of stuff. But what I've seen is it's a series of traumas are coming. And there are sweeping changes and situations coming, for sure. And the intensity is going to get, like an action, like a superhuman action movie, is going to get very wild. And it's like a call to action, the call to action has become very strong. You might call that the world's going to become like a video game. Call to action is going to be like a video game, really. Why do you think all these people are playing all these video games all the time, They're preparing for it. They're preparing for the call to action. It's going to happen externally now, not just in a video game. So, if you don't want to be called into action like that, you need to abide in satsang and get into that stream of those who have perfect non-effort, non-doing. I was able to get into that stream, the stream of Ananda Mahima in particular, which was a tremendous river of perfect non-action, perfect bliss, never even wavering, not needing anything at all to add to it. Not anything, not even the tiniest thing. Just sit there perfectly fulfilled every second without needing anything. So I got into that stream. And I knew it was possible. So I know this is possible here. And so if you don't want to get pulled into action, you need to get into that stream of non-action. Seriously, this is not just talk. This is real. You have to get into that stream of non-action. You have to hold that as in your intention, This is where your momentum is going to take you and say, I'm okay with that. My momentum is taking me towards abiding in non-action. In getting near that stream, dipping my toes in that stream, getting into the stream. that stream of God's grace of non-action in existence. And, you know, I'm not going to, at this point, I'm not going to put up pictures. I'm not into my mind. So, you know, nobody's interested. What they want is someone, you know, who's here now, right? That's what people really want. So, we have to get that. We have to make that our intention. And then we have to allow ourselves to be okay with getting into that attention, being attracted to that intention, and getting into that stream, hanging out with perfect, effortless non-action. And only that is protection during these times. Only that. And my world continues to be rocked right now. Continues. I can feel it. You know, whoa. Oh, it's not an energy thing, you know. I never experienced energy stuff at all. Never have. People, if someone says, "What's energy?" I have no idea what energy is. Tell you the truth, I really don't. I don't feel it. I don't experience it. This is, it's like world shaking though. The way I'm feeling is like my whole world is being shaken. Something is very imminent of profound magnitude. You know, great peace is imminent. Great non-action is imminent. It's that feeling. So, and I expect October to be an enormous blessing to those who want to get into the stream of effortless non-action. Enormous blessing. And it has to be. Because we cannot wait to the election, the U.S. election. We cannot wait. If we don't have the momentum again, and I say October is the time to establish the momentum of effortless non-action. And we will do it, and we have to do it before the election. After the election, the call to action is going to become very extreme. Very, very extreme. Because those who win the election will feel they need to permanently silence those who lost. And those who lost feel they need to put on a massive effort to overturn it or to resist it. So the call to action is going to be extreme. All over the world is going to become very extreme. Very, very extreme towards the end of this 2012. November, December. Going into December, towards the end of this year, the call to action is going to become critical. So we have to get this momentum established. And so far, I'm right on time. I'm always on time. And going in October, I expect in October that this momentum of effortless non-action will be established, and this momentum will begin. This momentum will begin before the election. I'm very determined about that. It's critical. We're really at a very critical crossroads right now. We will succeed. Just make that, you know, your intention. Align your intention. Say, yeah, effortless non-action. That's the direction I'm going to go in. Not I want, I am going to go in that direction. I'm going to do it now. And be confident of that. And just, you know, we've made our decision. August was decision time. September was moving on that decision. So the point within October could be momentum time. We could actually get the ball rolling in October. So we don't get pulled into action time in November and December. We don't get that call to action, you know. We get the call to non-action. We're already in non-action. And so the call to action, we can just say, ah, thanks, but no thanks. And then that's how you sidestep it, which I've been saying for years and years. There's a way to sidestep all this trouble. Absolutely, there is a way, and we will do it. Okay, very great. Happy October.